Testing 1, 2, 3. Welcome one and all to Rambling Aside, where we discuss stuff that we normally wouldn't on our major videos.
One and all, that's like 10 people. Probably not, no, it's not even 10, that's like one person.
One other person? You have that much faith?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, good. And today we watch, over the past weekend, we watched Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens. I watched it twice, and you watched it...
Three times. I was going to watch it a fourth time today, but I couldn't get it right.
Yeah. So what did you think about it?
Well, we should go over our experiences going to see it. Like, I already know your experiences because I was there, but...
Yeah, so tell us your first experience.
So my whole plan was I had... What day was it? I bought the tickets. I wanted to go see Krampus. And the same day I bought 3 tickets for me and my 2 brothers. We were going to go see it Thursday night at 10 p.m. 2D because I didn't want to pay for 3D.
Yeah, 3D is garbage.
And the whole plan was to go 2 hours early so that there'd be a line. We go 2 hours early, nobody's there. And my dad, he's like, there's not going to be a line here. Nobody cares about that movie here. So we go back until we go to wait for until 9:30. Since it's at 10 o'clock, we went at 8. So we go back at 9:30 and the lobby is full of people. Like from start of where the cinema is all the way back. So I was kind of pissed, but whatever. We ended up getting good seats anyway, and yeah, it was great, I guess.
But your first experience, you didn't like the movie at first.
No.
It was like a miserable experience.
It wasn't miserable. It was entertaining. But the more I thought about it, when I got home, talking with it with English friends who'd seen it, the more I thought about it, it's like, it's kind of crap. And some of that is stuck with me, but it's, as you know, second time seeing it, it's much better.
Your second time and my first time seeing it, we went to a cinema about 2 towns away with really nice seats, really nice sound, and I forgot my Star Wars shirt at home.
Oh, yeah.
So I hated myself all the way over there.
I forgot my lightsaber in your car.
Yeah.
Because we switched cars suddenly.
Yeah, we suddenly switched cars, and you forgot your lightsaber, I forgot my Star Wars shirt. It was a disaster.
Yeah.
So when we got over there, I was expecting the movie to be terrible. Although you were keeping mum, and I do appreciate that.
Yeah.
But when we got over there, boom! The most awesome thing ever.
Yeah, not most awesome. It was pretty good, though.
Yeah, well. I would say it's comparable with the original trilogy.
Yeah.
Not better than, but comparable.
Better than Jedi, I would say.
That's a steep thing to live up to. Although people have said that that's the worst of the original trilogy.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't dislike it.
No, I don't dislike it either. It's just... Han Solo's kind of useless. Ewoks are dumb. The best part is Luke Skywalker facing Darth Vader and Palpatine.
Yeah.
That's such a small part of the movie. There's more going on in this movie.
Yeah, this movie was so competently made in an action-packed environment that I dare say that it was beyond competent. I would say that it's near masterpiece material.
I don't know about that.
I know people have many complaints to have about this movie. But for all the complaints, it is still a solid movie experience with a lot of emotion behind it. So, let's talk about the elephant in the room and discuss what we thought was going to happen. The movie that I thought was going to happen didn't necessarily happen. Although many things that I inferred actually did happen. I mean, not the Darth Jar Jar and the Death Hoth like I was hoping.
Yeah.
That movie would have been awesome, but what we got instead was still pretty darn good. My initial reaction to seeing the movie the first time was delightful bewilderment, because I was expecting it to be terrible. I was expecting something on par with the prequels, but I was delightfully surprised. We have a running theory that it's the seats that make the movie, because after you saw it the second time,
It was great.
Yeah, you found it much more enjoyable.
First time, I was just nitpicking it to death. But even, like you said, I saw it three times. First time I saw it, I was entertained by it. I wasn't, wowed by it like the second time. But I got out and I started thinking about it. I was like, man, that was awful. Why did I hate seeing it so much? And you see it the second time, we go to a better theater in a, would you say, wealthier town?
Yeah, much wealthier.
So, they have better seats, better picture. Like, I was noticing the third time we saw it, the image was scratched, like, their screens are scratched. And every time, I don't know what happens, every time I go to sit in their seats, my pants, like, slowly start coming down. Every time I go to that theater, I don't understand it. It's something about those seats that caused my, I don't know. It's very weird. But first time I saw it, hated it. Well, liked it, then hated it. Third time, I was just kind of bored by it. And both 1 and 3 were both at that same theater. But the second one is at a good theater with good seats. I loved it. So, but I've never had seats destroy a movie before, so I'm not sure what it is.
It's not going to that cinema anymore. That's the only solution.
Well, I mean, I liked Krampus and I saw it at that theater. I don't get it.
Yeah, it seems totally dependent on how comfortable you are at the moment of seeing it.
That's why it could be that we saw Krampus and then saw Star Wars like right after, and spending that much time.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Of course, when we saw Star Wars when I saw it for the second time, your third time, it was a little more crowded, and the theater was a little bit smaller.
Oh, that guy laughing didn't help things.
Oh, God.
Okay. So
funny. While we're on the podcast, if you're that guy, and you're the one sitting behind someone really trying to pay attention, and you're like, oh, no. Oh, no, he didn't. Oh, come on. Oh, no, did you see that?
Like,
that was Han Solo. That's R2-D2.
The worst part, princess or General Leia shows up on screen for the first time and starts laughing. I'm like,
nothing funny was going on.
Come on, guy. He was so loud about everything.
I mean, it takes all kinds, I suppose, but if you're gonna be that guy, stay home. Seriously, wait for a less crowded time to not see the movie around people who really want to see the movie and enjoy the movie, and not your commentary. Commentaries are for YouTube videos. Definitely the crowd can make the movie for you or break it, because...
Oh, the crowd at the first time I saw it was great. They, like, the first time I've seen it in theaters, Star Wars shoots on screen, and people yelling and they're clapping, and these kids in the front with their lightsabers swinging them around. It's like, yeah, it's pretty awesome seeing that in the theater. Because this is my first Star Wars movie in theaters. And then everybody was respectful throughout the rest of it.
That's good, because the second time we saw it, everyone was pretty respectful. There was only one crying baby. Oh, yeah, parents, don't bring your crying babies to the theater.
Yeah,
it's rude.
I was so scared that baby was going to scream throughout the movie. Get a babysitter. Do something.
Yeah, I mean, I know you want to see the movie, but find someone to watch the baby for a couple of hours and watch the movie without a crying baby. But the baby was quiet throughout the majority of the movie. Didn't interrupt my viewing experience. There was a little kid sitting just a couple of seats away from me beside her grandpa, and I thought she was going to talk throughout the whole movie real loud, but she was whispering and being real respectful and I can respect that. Mm-hmm. That little girl's first Star Wars. Yeah, I enjoyed the first time I watched it. The second time, I still enjoyed it. But I already knew everything that was going to happen, so I was less excited. It did allow me to pay attention more to the background details.
Mm-hmm. I think that's part of why I liked it more the second time also.
Mm-hmm. I really took note of all the special effects that they used and the moderation that they put forth. I hate to say, you know, moderation is a good thing because you want more of something, but they didn't make everything CG, and the CG that they used for expression and to amplify. Like, there was this large pig monster drinking out of a trough, and they used CGI to make its movements a little more natural. Probably added some splashes or some breathing effects and stuff. And, yeah, I really enjoyed it. I can't think of any real weaknesses to the movie, only just a few slight plot holes that are brought up. The detective watched it on my second viewing, Butcher's third viewing, and, he hated it.
He didn't hate it.
Okay, he thought it was boring.
He came out saying that he liked,
Krampus better.
He came out saying that he wanted more X-Wings and more Death Star. I was like, really? That's what I wanted less of.
Yeah, it really needed less of the first movie. I know that's weird, but... Okay, let's go ahead and get into spoilers. Show a big spoiler symbol on the screen. Yeah, there you go. Whatever. So we start the movie out on Jakku in a little desert town area, and an old man is handing a young pilot a little data card.
Yeah.
This data card holds a secret. The map to Luke Skywalker, only it's just a small portion of it. So he hides it in his little ball droid, BB-8, or B-88, or whatever.
Yeah. The character's name is Lor-San Tekka. And he's played by... Old Priest in Exorcist.
Yeah, the Priest in Exorcist.
Max von Sydow. Also Emperor Ming in Flash Gordon.
Oh, wow. That was him, wasn't it?
Yeah. I watched Flash Gordon the other night, and that's all I could hear was that old guy in the desert.
Yeah.
Gives him the chip. BB-8 comes in saying, beep, boop, bop, which translates to, holy crap, we're going to die.
Stormtroopers is coming.
Initially they run to Poe Dameron's X-Wing. And BB-8 gets inside of it, and he gets inside of it, and then stormtroopers fire at him, and then he gives the chip to BB-8 and tells the robot to run away.
Yeah, run away and don't get caught by stormtroopers. And good news, everyone, the screen wipes are there.
Oh, yeah, that's something I was really scared of.
Yeah, you were going to lose your mind.
It was like, what's the one thing they would get rid of for old Star Wars? And luckily they didn't do it.
Thank God for that.
In fact, they went farther whenever BB-8 is leaving the village.
Mm-hmm.
You see that? That,
circle wiper?
No, that not very well articulated puppet come up with the eyes. It comes up, looks at him, and then ducks back into the sand. I thought that was great because it looked so cheap. It was great.
Also at this village, we get to meet our first protagonist, Finn, the stormtrooper.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wait, we got to talk about Kylo Ren, because he appears first, I believe.
Okay, we'll talk about Kyle.
Yeah.
Because when I become a Darth Lord, I'm going to have a cool name. won't be Vader or Maul. It'll be Kyle. I'll be Kyle, the Dark Lord. Boy, that was a... That's a weird thing. Especially when we find out who he is.
Mm-hmm.
But in our first scene that we see him, we learn that he is trying to be Darth Vader. He's trying to be menacing.
Well,
we get to see him exhibit his powers in stopping a laser blast. Which in Return of the Jedi, we see Darth Vader, like Han Solo pulls a pistol on Darth Vader, and Darth Vader like lifts his hand and blocks all the laser blasts.
I think you're thinking of Empire. They're in Cloud
City.
Oh,
it is Empire. Yeah. You're right.
Han Solo comes in and he's like, pew, shit. And then Darth Vader pulls his gun away from him.
Yeah. So we actually see this power before. I was thinking that this was a brand new power, but we see Kylo Ren stop a laser blast in midair. And it's like vibrating in place because he's holding it with his willpower, and he makes Poe Dameron fall to his knees. And Poe exhibits some character.
Okay.
I love his little character lines of, you know, I can't hear you because of the, thing of your face.
The apparatus.
Would you kindly speak up? Because I can't hear you because of your face. Something's wrong with your face.
And it makes me wrong about one of my initial things. And the other one, I said Poe Dameron would be not Han Solo, which he is, and not Wedge Antilles, which he is. But he's also not Leia, because she's the one who talked back to Darth Vader.
Yeah.
In A New Hope.
So Poe actually exhibits a lot of features from the original trilogy, which makes him fit in much more than I thought he would.
Yeah, I think he's probably my favorite. And he has, like, the least screen time.
Which is probably a good thing. Yeah. That means we aren't tired of him when we see him. And Kylo Ren is trying to be Darth Vader. He's trying to impose upon his foes.
That doesn't really come into light later. Until later.
Well, we see him tromping, stomping around, being all bad and mean, and he orders the stormtroopers to kill the villagers because they're of no use anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So we get to see his character. We get to see Phasma for a few seconds give an order.
Awful.
Yeah. We'll get more into Phasma in just a second, I guess. Anyway, we see Finn. His buddy dies in his arms. And his buddy wipes blood over his face so that we can tell who Finn is. It's honestly a really good way to set him apart from the other stormtroopers so we know who he is.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and Finn is the one who shot his friend. I don't wonder if that'll come into play in the next movie.
Finn shot his friend?
No, Poe shot his friend.
Yeah, Poe shot his friend. Which Poe was just fighting back with his laser cannon thing on his X-Wing. But yeah, Poe shot his buddy as he was running and shooting up the village. And Finn is shaken. He's kind of shell-shocked. He doesn't fire upon the villagers. He's just kind of standing around looking pretty stupid for a stormtrooper. They get back to the ship, Poe in tow. Poe is kidnapped, and Phasma tells Finn to turn in his weapon and go to reconditioning or something so that he can be debriefed. And I don't think he goes. Like, I think he gets his armor cleaned and then he wanders away. Poe gets tortured by Kylo Ren into answering his questions, which is a pretty good scene. We get to see Kylo Ren demonstrate his force powers a little bit more in reading people's minds.
Mm-hmm.
And he does the little kid thing where he reaches his hand out in front of Finn's Poe's face and goes, "You will tell me what you know." And then he tells him what he knows.
Well, at first he doesn't. Not until he
resists.
Yeah. Starts torturing him, like inflicting pain on him.
So, I felt that was kind of a callback to The Empire Strikes Back when Darth Vader is torturing Han Solo. I thought that was pretty appropriate.
It's not used in the scene, but behind Kylo, is a...
One of those droid things that... What, tortured Princess Leia?
Yeah.
That's a pretty good callback. I like that. I saw that in the background the second time I watched it. And then we get to see the general. What's his name?
Hux.
Yeah, General Huxtable. I don't know. I didn't care for General Hux. He left no impression upon me until his big speech.
Oh, yeah.
That's when he came off as a real Hitler. And I'm like, oh, wow. Symbolism.
He uses the word acquiesces in that speech.
Yeah.
What a word.
But, then we meet our second main character, Rey, on planet Jakku. And she's scavenging garbage off of old Star Destroyers and stuff. She's living in a AT-AT that's been overturned. She wears an old Rogue One helmet or something.
Oh,
old Rebel helmet.
I read something. I went to Walmart last night with...
the detective.
Yeah, and... something called Rey Survival Guide, and it goes into these characters' backgrounds. And said the helmet belonged to somebody named, the name started with D something Rey, R-A-E-H. So I am guessing Rey is not her real name.
Yeah, I think Rey isn't her real name either.
Just like Finn isn't
Finn's real name.
Finn's real name. His name is, or his number is FN2187.
We get to meet Rey, see her world a little bit, and she meets up with B-88 or BB-8, whatever his name is.
BB-8.
BB-8, whatever. And he gets to be a cute little droid, almost like a lost puppy. He can't tell her his mission, but he knows he has a mission. And they go into town. Meanwhile, on the Star Destroyer, which, by the way, the Star Destroyer, I want to mention, is like the compensator of Star Destroyers. It's like a Star Destroyer stacked on top of a Star Destroyer. It's bigger and meaner looking. And Kylo Ren's ship is like the Emperor's ship, except bigger and meaner. It's all trying to compensate for something. Everything about the First Order is trying to compensate.
Speaking of Star Destroyers, the opening shot is shot of a planet
being over-encompassed.
And then Star Destroyer comes in and puts it in shadow, you know, the darkness blocking out the light. But I was thinking about the spoilers that I had read, since now that we've seen it, I can talk about everything that I had heard. I heard that the opening shot would be Luke's and Anakin's blue lightsaber floating through space for some reason and crash landing on Jakku. And I was thinking, oh god, please no.
That would be stupid and pointless.
And then they didn't do it, so thank god for that.
I'm glad they didn't do that. God, that would have been so stupid. But, man, that just threw me off. Finn breaks Poe Dameron off out of the Star Destroyer, and they get into a new TIE fighter and shoot up the place and break out and fall to Jakku. We get to see Phasma's second scene out of three. I think she has a total of three scenes in the movie.
Yeah, probably.
Get to see her second scene where she's explaining that they sent Finn back to get reconditioned, but he didn't ever showed up, and he broke out, and that's why they escaped. Whoops.
She's talking to General Hux.
And we actually get a good nod, in my opinion, to the new trilogy, where...
prequels?
Yeah, where Kylo Ren is saying... you know, maybe we should use clone army, and General Hux is like, no! Our soldiers are raised from infants. We kidnap them, and we train them up to be really good soldiers, and drain them of emotion and everything. So I think that's a pretty good nod, you know, Kylo Ren saying, yeah, we could totally do clones right now. In fact, it'd probably be easier. In fact, next movie, clones. Hundreds and hundreds of clones.
You think they would do that?
Oh, I know they would do that.
I don't know.
They would have Jar Jar show up and say, oh no, here we go again! And then Clone Wars again. We have Poe waking up out of the destroyed TIE fighter thinking that Poe is dead. Finn wakes up. Poe's presumed dead. He gets his jacket. He sheds his stormtrooper armor. And he goes to town. The only point of civilization he can find. And it just so happens to be the same point of civilization that Rey's at.
Yeah.
The coincidences start mounting. Bump, ba-da-da-dump, ba-da-da-dump. Coincidence! So, BB-8 sees the jacket and he's like, hey, that black guy stole my master's jacket.
And then they start beating him with a stick and tasing him.
Yeah, they tase him and beat him with a stick and make him wish he weren't alive. He's like, oh, man, I helped Poe get out, but I think he's dead. I'm sorry. Totally didn't mean to do that. BB-8 shows so much emotion, it's kind of funny. Because the main characters are bad at showing emotion.
Are they?
Finn can show pretty good range of emotion, but Rey, she's kind of a blank slate. She can either be sad or bored. And, which the actress is very good. I'm sure she's going to improve over the next few movies. But,
This is her first movie, like, ever.
Yeah. So she's got room to grow. But she's far from bad.
A lot of people have been complaining about her acting. And I was concerned about it because J.J. Abrams said she started out wooden as an actress, and so did Peter Mayhew, saying, oh god, no, don't be another Anakin. And thankfully she wasn't. A lot of people keep complaining about her, but
she's not the worst part of the movie. Like, there's very few worst parts of the movie, but she's not one of them. Anyway, she and Finn meet up. They find the Millennium Falcon, go into it because the Empire has come to collect the droid with the map to Luke Skywalker on him, and they escape. They go into space. There's a nice little air combat where the Millennium Falcon is running from two TIE fighters, and we get to see that Rey is good at flying, and she's mechanically minded.
Shows, and a lot of people say that Rey's character is too perfect, but we know, or we can presume, that she's used to flying that quad jumper, that quad engine ship thing. Because whenever she gets in the Millennium Falcon, she messes up here and there.
Yeah, when she starts up the Millennium Falcon, it drags the ground and everything. It's like, wow, you're gonna scratch the paint, guys. You don't want to do that.
Oh yeah, the whatever they're escaping from, the TIE fighters. They're running and they're going towards the quad engine ship, and then it blows up. Or she makes comments like, "That ship is garbage."
And let's go to the quad jumper.
And the quad jumper explodes. And it's like the garbage will do, and they turn, and there's the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, and it gets me because no one recognizes that it's the Millennium Falcon. I know it's a Cresselian...
or Corellian freighter.
Yeah, so it's just a freighter ship.
Yeah.
It's not actually, you know, the top-of-the-line ship even anymore. But why doesn't anyone recognize that that's a thing? Shouldn't that be like the DeLorean of spaceships, since it blew up two Death Stars now?
I mean...
It blew up one Death Star and helped blow up another.
What are the chances that the Millennium Falcon would be there, though?
What are the chances that it's going to be the DeLorean from the movie? You're still going to buy it. And you're still going to be like, ah, this is my passion. Mm-hmm. People would be buying up those old freighters, being like, this is the same kind of ship that blew up the Death Star. The big one. So, anyway, no one recognizes that it's the Millennium Falcon, but it's totally the Millennium Falcon. Because while Finn and Rey are in space. A giant freighter ship comes up and swallows up the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah.
And Poe and Rey, Finn and Rey are like, oh no, we've got to flood the room with poison gas to kill off the stormtroopers.
Was that a reference to Phantom Menace? The beginning of the movie?
It very well could be.
The room filling up with poison gas? It's like Mr. Plinkett said, wait, how does he know it's a poisonous gas before...
Before he smells it? Did he get a whiff?
Oh, I guess he just got a little whiff. So they don't call it poisonous gas whenever they're trying to turn off the... or they're trying to fix the ship. But whenever they think stormtroopers are coming on board, then it's poisonous gas. And they didn't put on the mask the first time.
Well, yeah, it was about to fill with poisonous gas. It could have been a reference. I don't know. I don't think so, but it very well could be. But, turns out it's Han Solo and Chewie.
Yeah.
Han Solo bought this old big freighter and he's gotten back into smuggling crap.
I don't know. Finn thought it was the First Order, so I'm assuming he stole a freighter from the First Order. Maybe.
That could be it. I don't know. It seems a little dirty and old for the First Order, but it could very well be. But, apparently Han Solo's been floating around in space doing his job, and he keeps his computer permanently set on so that he can find any Millennium Falcon floating through space with a signature, radio signature.
It's just one. It's just one Millennium Falcon.
Okay, Kessel freighter ship. Whatever. Chrysalian.
Corellian freighter.
Corellian freighter blah blah blah.
I'm gonna be so pissed if I looked it up later while editing this and find out I'm saying it wrong or that I got the wrong term.
Yeah, we'll live. But he's been looking for this ship because it was stolen from him years ago. Probably when him and Leia were having kids and being a family.
Unkar Plutt stole it from somebody. They stole it from someone else who stole it from Han Solo. Something like that.
Han Solo comes across Millennium Falcon. Him and Chewie have been looking for it for ages. And, I was sad to not see senile old Han Solo. I wanted to see decrepit Han Solo with his cane coming in. He's carrying his breathing, like his oxygen tank behind him.
You can't get off my ship! Sounds like Darth Vader now.
Yeah. 89 years old and carrying around like an old cane blaster.
You know the old concept art for the original Star Wars?
No.
And one of them, Luke Skywalker, is fighting Darth Vader.
Mm-hmm.
And he's wearing a breathing apparatus because he's in space. That's what they should have gave Han Solo.
Yeah.
He can't breathe.
He should have been so old and brittle and frail. But no, he's Harrison Ford. Harrison Ford's too badass to be old. And Chewie, I don't think he even has gray hairs, but even if he did, I guess their species lives forever, because Yetis live forever.
He looked younger than he did in the old movies.
Yeah, in a way. But,
I wonder if they'll change his costume for the next movie.
I hope not.
Yeah.
But, Chewbacca was probably the best character in the movie.
He finally has character.
Yeah, in the other movies...
He got little bits of character in the old ones, but this one, he really got character, I think.
Yeah, the other ones, you know, like in the first movie, he put his hands behind his head when Han Solo said he could rip your arms off. He was like, oh, I could totally do it. Oh. So in this movie, he expressed himself much more and much better. He made up for his lackluster appearance in Revenge of the Sith. Because, wow.
He didn't really even need to appear in that movie.
No, he just showed up in the background. It was
remember
like,
me, guys?
Show up and put on the costume, show up, and just stand there and look pretty.
He's been dressing like that for 60 years.
But, yeah, in this we get to see Han Solo actually do some smuggling.
Mm-hmm.
Because we've never actually seen him do smuggling before. It's always implied or that he could do it, but he doesn't do it right now because he's in the middle of a plot. So, yeah, he's smuggling these slaughter beasts, these...
Wrathtars.
Like, you know something's mean when it has wrath in its name.
Cthulhu beautiful. Monsters.
Yeah, tentacled death beasts that he's just keeping on the ship.
A lot of people have a problem with this scene, but like you were saying, we've never seen Han Solo smuggle anything before. He's like, right now he's smuggling something as he found the Millennium Falcon, so why not follow up on it? It doesn't really add anything.
Well, it all gives it them out.
All it adds is that...
they have a reason to get on the Millennium Falcon. Like, that's the only reason that they get on the Millennium Falcon and leave.
Oh, yeah.
That is Han Solo's call to action. Because they're like, you've got to help us get this message to General Leia. And Han's like, you can go take it to General Leia. I have a freighter ship full of wrath blah blahs to come and rip my throat out if I don't get them delivered right now. And then space pirates come up and mess up his thing. And actually, Rey presses some fuses.
Oh, yeah, that's another way she messes up. She thinks she's pressing fuses to...
to the doors to lock them.
To lock the gangs out, and then she lets the Wrathars out. So I don't get where... I don't get why people think she's such a perfect character. She fucks up plenty, I think.
Yeah, she has her character flaws. She doesn't know every technology she's touching. But she knows enough to know that those were fuses.
Yeah.
And she presses them, and these wrath blah blahs come out and eat all the pirates and almost eat Finn. I don't know why they didn't just chew him up like they did everyone else, because you see the Wrathtars slinging pirates around and yum 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 right there. But no, this one's going to drag Finn away and save him for later, I guess. But Rey closes a door on the monster's tentacles, and Finn's like, oh god,
happy. And then the door is just like, well, that was lucky. Yeah, I thought, I get it. But the only problem I have with that scene is the CGI.
Yeah, the CGI was a little sloppy, but...
it looked like part of it could have been, like,
A practical thing.
Yeah, but, like, the tentacles were like CGI. I'm not really sure. I'd have to watch it again.
You'd have to study it scene by scene. I don't know. I thought it was appropriate, because it is the call to action. We get, a pirate shooting Chewie in the arm, and Chewie's like, oh, my arm! Why?
I think that scene has my favorite sound design, because I love the sound of the Guavian Death Gang. Like, the way their suits sound whenever they move, they got, like, this cybernetic sound to them that I really like.
I didn't even notice that.
Yeah, I loved it. It is kind of weird how their leader was like a... he wasn't wearing a mask. He's just some Scottish guy, or Irish guy. I can't remember his accent. Very well.
Yeah, why are there Scottish people in space? Why are there British people in space?
I don't know.
Why does nothing make sense anymore? Anyway.
It was Guavian Death Gang and Kanji Club.
Yeah, these two gangs get eaten up by Wrathtars, and they leave Han Solo's big space freighter behind. It's floating through space now. And they escape in the Millennium Falcon, and Han Solo takes them to, what's that?
Maz Kanata?
Yeah, Maz Kanata, blah, blah, blah. He's like, everything that you heard in the stories are true. It's all true.
They go to her castle to get a ship that's not being tracked.
Yeah.
He's like, if I can track it, you know damn well that the First Order can track it.
And we get to see Kylo Ren in the Star Destroyer, and they're explaining where they're going, and he's like, what girl?
Mm.
How did they escape? How did the droid escape? The stormtrooper and a girl. What girl?
Or
chokes a guy, throws a fit.
Where's the droid? And the guy says, they stole a freighter. And Kylo's like, a droid stole a freighter? He's like, no, he had help. And then, something, I forget.
So, we get to see Kylo Ren being kind of petulant, kind of a spoiled brat.
Oh, yeah, that's the scene where he tears up that console
with his
lightsaber. That was awesome.
That's probably the temperature controls. It's going to be hot as hell in that thing now. The thermostat is stuck to 85 degrees. Kylo Ren's going to be sweating in his mask all day. Gosh, I wish I hadn't done that.
I'm trying to I don't really know why, but I'm trying to think of why Kylo Ren works and Anakin doesn't.
Well, we'll get to that. We see Maz Kanata, and she's in this bar. We get to hear some more,
jizz.
Yeah, some more jizz. Space jazz, which is jizz.
Gross. It's like space reggae.
Yeah.
In this one.
Which, I'm glad we finally have another song to play to death instead of the Cantina song. I'm so sick of those songs. The Jabba Palace song and the Cantina song are so tired.
What are the names of those songs?
Jedi something and...
No, you're thinking of Jedi Rocks. We don't talk about that. Lapti Nick. That's the name of the original song that was in place of Jedi Rocks.
Lapti Nick.
Lapti Nick. L-A-P-T-I space N-E-K.
Okay. Cool. Anyway, we get a new song, and it's pretty refreshing to have a new song.
Wasn't on the soundtrack, though, unfortunately.
Maz Kanata, you know, stops the entire congregation from talking so she can say, "Where's my boyfriend, Chewie? I would like that Wookiee. I'd like to sit in his lap sometimes and just curl his hair."
You were talking about something like that, saying how Maz Kanata would have a crush on Han Solo.
Yeah.
You were almost right.
Almost. Something I said that was ridiculous almost came true, which scares me.
Yeah.
It scared me because on the way to the theater, you were like, "Something you said is almost true." And I'm like, "Oh God, I've said some ridiculous things. Please don't let Darth Jar Jar come out and be like, 'Misa is Dark Emperor.'" So that doesn't happen in this movie. Thank God for that. Second movie, though. Looking forward to it. She's kind of mystical, but she's not strong with the Force, but she knows that it exists and that it works around her and everything. She has big goggles over her eyes, and her eyes are real tiny. I knew that was going to happen. She's keeping all sorts of garbage in her basement, and one of these articles calls to Rey while Finn is trying to get a freighter off the planet so he can run to the farthest reaches of the galaxy so the First Order won't find him.
He wants to get to the Outer Rim so that way...
First Order won't find him and everything. Yeah. So that's cool. But Rey is...
She starts to hear a child crying.
Yeah, so she goes down, opens a trunk, and there, lo and behold, is Anakin Skywalker's lightsaber. The same lightsaber that Luke was using in the second movie when he had his hand cut off, and the lightsaber fell into Bespin's air ducts. So, that lightsaber was hovering over a city, floating over a gas giant. So that lightsaber is, it fell onto a gas giant. There should be no reason that that lightsaber exists. It should either be crushed in the atmosphere of a planet that has no form, or
it should be... We're talking about Star Wars science, though.
It'll be in an air duct in Bespin somewhere, and a little pig man will have found it and say, "Ring, ring, 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 ring."
Yeah.
So, that happens.
Yeah.
We see this lightsaber, and Rey extends her hand out to it. Go ahead.
I have no problems with them having a lightsaber. I know a lot of people do. Just don't give me a scene where it's floating in space and it crashes to a planet. I mean...
Yeah.
Just let somebody have it, explain it later, but whatever.
I kind of wish that it was Luke's lightsaber, though. That would have made more sense in context for me. But since it is the original blue lightsaber... Okay.
Well, I mean, it makes sense in the context that Kylo Ren is really obsessed with Darth Vader.
Yeah. So, which I guess the green lightsaber was blown up with the new Death Star.
What was it?
Because Luke dropped it and didn't pick it back up, and...
I'd have to watch it again.
Yeah. Anyway, so... blue lightsaber, Rey touches it and has a Silent Hill flashback.
Yeah.
We see a bunch of scenes, hands, figures.
She goes to Cloud City. In one of them. Like that hallway?
Mm-hmm.
That's Cloud City. I know because I watched Empire not too long ago.
Oh.
That's the hallway that Darth Vader and Luke start fighting in an Empire.
That's neat. So, she sees scenes from past, present, and future, presumably. She hears old Obi-Wan call her name, which is taken from a soundbite of something else.
Something where Alec Guinness is saying the word afraid, and they take the syllable Rey out of it.
So he says, Rey!
And then it's followed up with Obi-Wan, Alec, or what's his name? Ewan Mc... Oh my god, I can't remember the name. The
new Obi-Wan.
Prequel Obi-Wan says, these are your first steps. And there's a short clip of Yoda saying, surrounds us, binds us, something like that. Talking about the Force. They're all talking about the Force in some manner.
So, a lot of baggage is connected to this lightsaber. This is now a legacy item.
Ewan McGregor.
Ewan McGregor. Okay, cool. And then she's like, I'm not going to touch that ever again. And Maz Kanata comes up and says, the Force is calling you. You have to answer the call.
We got to talk about this since this is where it's brought up. Rey being Luke's daughter, yay or nay?
Yes.
Nay.
I'm saying yes.
And I say this because Maz says, this saber this saber was Luke's and his father before him, and now it calls to you. Which, in that context, you could think, okay, that's the kid. But she also says, you know that your family is not coming back, but there's someone who still could come back. And she says, Luke, I think if they wanted her to be Luke's daughter, they would outright reveal it and not be all wishy-washy about it. I think Han and Leia would say something about it. I don't know.
I don't, because she's been gone for so long, they probably never saw her.
I think at most, Rey at one point was adopted by Luke for some reason.
Anyway, so then the Empire comes and blows up Maz Kanata's stuff. Rey is running around outside being all dramatic because she doesn't want the responsibility of the Force upon her. Mm. And Finn is being all dramatic and stuff. Things are blown up. And the First Order fires the Death Planet's laser gun. Yeah. They've been building a death laser out of a planet. So that much is true. But it's not Hoth. Even though I really wanted it to be Hoth.
It's practically Hoth. There's just a bunch of snow and...
Yeah, but there's trees on it, so...
Yeah.
I mean, it's not Hoth, but I wish it was Hoth. But yes, they built a very impractical weapon. At most, the solar system that they are in has two suns. Because they fired it once, and they fired it a second time. So this weapon can absorb the energy from a sun into its being...
Mm-hmm.
And fire a focused energy beam that kind of scatters out and blows up other planets. And they use this to destroy the Republic. The Republic planet and moons.
Hosnian system. Hosnian Prime.
Hosnian Prime. So it's not...
Hosnian Prime is the capital with all those people. The prequel city looking thing. Is what they blew up.
It's not the prequel planet.
It's not Coruscant.
Man, I wish it was Coruscant. That would have been a really awesome bird finger to the prequels.
It's too far. I mean, it's already kind of like, fuck you, but it's not like...
Okay, so it's not an official fuck you, but it's almost like... Yeah, see the city that looks exactly like Coruscant?
Fuck you! All I know about that scene is that that planet is called Hosnian Prime, and that one bearded puppet guy you see is supposedly the leader of the whole thing.
Okay. So that's weird. So they demonstrate their power after the General Hux makes his big Nazi speech, and all the stormtroopers raise their right hand And they're like, we're Nazis!
They're like doing the Black Power thing.
Oh, it's Black Power? I thought their hands were straight out. Because
they're like, yeah! Probably because their armor won't let them do this.
Oh, their arms can't straight
out. I would assume.
Okay. So yeah, they're Nazis. Space Nazis, so that works. Yeah. I'm like, okay, that'll do.
The concept art for Starkiller was way more Nazi than it is now. It's like that old footage, like you'll see in Triumph of the Will, you'll see those three banners side by side. That was practically it. Like, they already had those banners.
Yeah.
But it was like way more obvious in the concept art.
So we had that. They blew up. So Finn, Han Solo, and Rey all see this happen. Well, they all see this death laser go across the galaxy. And it's kind of their call to action. The Empire's already blowing Maz Kanata stuff up, so Finn and Han Solo and Maz Kanata and that group have to deal with that while Rey is being chased down by Kylo Ren.
Mm-hmm.
And Rey puts up a fight, but not much of a fight, and is kidnapped for her trouble. Finn, Han Solo, Chewie, they're almost kidnapped. We don't see Maz Kanata again. I wonder if she's hiding in her hole.
Well, she comes out with
Han Solo.
Han, Chewie, and Finn. And she hands Finn the lightsaber to take it to Rey.
So I guess she goes back into her basement.
But she just kind of disappears. Supposedly there's a deleted scene where she goes back to the Resistance base.
Oh.
But it was cut out because it said it added nothing to the movie.
So Finn has the lightsaber, and he's all like, "Yeah, I can play with this." You.
Yeah.
Until this one stormtrooper comes out with his super ultra baton with energy.
He's a riot trooper, I guess.
Yeah, I don't even know why he had that, because he had like a little blast shield and a baton anyway. Then he's like, "Oh no!" Throws them down.
He had a blaster and a shield.
Blaster and a shield.
Yeah.
The first stormtrooper with a shield.
Yeah.
And then he pulls out this big... And Finn is not prepared.
People love that stormtrooper. You know how you make Captain Phasma a cool character, like they wanted her to be?
You make her pull
out a big... You make her the one
fighting
him in that scene?
That would have been awesome. But you couldn't have the awesome death scene where, like, Han Solo picks up Chewie's blaster and, like, hammer this. Tosses him like a rag doll.
Yeah.
Awesome death.
I mean, you could
totally
have,
worth
you could have tossed Captain Phasma like that.
Yeah,
and
then
fuck her up.
She would have had more worth to her. We would have all been like, man, she was awesome. Nope, didn't happen.
Somebody made a post about that saying, clearly, Captain Phasma was supposed to be another Boba Fett. Somebody who has very little screen time but would be awesome. And they do create that character, but it's some random stormtrooper.
Yeah,
and
some
it's not Captain
nameless
Phasma.
Stormtrooper who we wish was that awesome. Mm-hmm. In fact, if they drug him back and gave him a face, it's like, yeah, I have this big laser baton. What of it? You're going to be my new general. Because you're moderately more awesome.
Like, Captain Phasma didn't even appear in that scene.
No. I don't.
Like,
no.
There's stormtroopers storming the planet. You'd think she would be ahead of them, telling them where to go.
With her big cape and everything.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm progressive because I'm a woman in man's armor. Oh, boy, look at me. She does nothing.
Oh, yeah, those complaints I had in the other one. They don't really... Even if it is what influenced casting, it didn't ruin it for me. It might have ruined Captain Phasma because they really didn't write her very well. But
so anyway, Finn gets tromped, and then they all get kind of arrested. Their weapons are taken away, and then the Rebel Squadron comes in, and they shoot up all the stormtroopers with their like six X-Wings.
Mm-hmm.
One of the complaints I've heard is, where are all the other ships? The Y-Wings, the A-Wings.
I was thinking about that just now.
B-Wings. Why are there only X-Wings? Which X-Wings are the ones that everyone wants, I suppose, yeah. But...
I think, thinking about it now, it kind of makes sense. The Rebels, they were a huge force taking on a giant government.
Mm-hmm.
Now they're a small force, a part of a giant government, taking on a small terrorist organization, basically.
Yeah, they're basically special forces right now. Funded by the Republic, but not officially
it kind of makes sense. Kind of makes sense that the First Order would just have TIE fighters, and it kind of makes sense that Resistance would only have X-Wings.
It keeps it simple, anyway.
Yeah.
We may get more vehicles in the next movies. Regardless, the X-Wings come in, and they're all victorious, and they run off the Empire. But Rey is kidnapped, and Kylo Ren has her. And
yeah.
He's going to interrogate her, because she's seen the map.
He just knocks her out. He waves his hand over her, and she gets knocked out.
Not before, like, bending her arm behind her back with the Force and making her vibrate in place a little bit. Because when you're held by the Force, at least when he's doing it, you vibrate in place a little bit. Because he's exerting his Force upon you, I guess. I don't know. Regardless, it's a cool effect. Finn, Chewie, Han, they meet up with the Resistance. General Leia's all like, "Hey, Han, how are you?"
Hi, Leia.
Oh,
They comment on Han's jacket looking the same. He's like, "Same jacket." He's like, "No, new jacket." I was like, "Well, yeah, I knew it was a new jacket, but it looks very similar."
I thought it looked kind of different, but
there was a lot of things where they were pointing out things people had problems with, like even whenever they're pointing out the new Death Star.
Yeah.
Han's like, "So it's just bigger, who cares?
We can still blow it up."
And they're like, "No, it's not a Death Star, it's bigger." I'm like, "Oh." Like, they knew people would be annoyed with it.
It's still the same plan, though, so they still like, "Oh, well, we can still blow it up." Yeah, Han's right. Well, what do you mean Han's right? Of course he's right. There's still a way to blow it up, we just gotta find a way. Turns out it's going on the planet and placing little mine explosives.
And blowing up a central...
Which
we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Those explosives look like the same one that Leia used in Return of the Jedi.
Oh, yeah. But instead of like having like a fold-back thing, it's just a button.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought that was pretty neat. Yeah, we're getting ahead of ourselves. They make a plan to blow up the Death Star, and the Rebels are going to strike back. So, Kylo Ren is interrogating Rey.
And he takes off his mask.
Yes, and now let's talk about Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
So Kylo Ren is Anakin Skywalker done better.
Yeah.
It's actually hard to describe why he is better. He is whiny. He is petulant. He is self-serving, just like Anakin.
Maybe it's the dialogue?
It's because he's a bad guy. We aren't supposed to think, he's a good guy, but tortured.
Oh, yeah, that's true. He's already a bad guy, so.
In the prequels, we hear about what a good Jedi Anakin is, but all we see is Anakin being a petulant, stupid brat. "I hate sand. It gets everywhere. I killed them all. Even the women and the children. My mom's dead. I gotta listen to Linkin Park songs." So, when Kylo Ren is whiny and petulant, it's not played up as, "Oh, he's a good guy." No, he's, like, feeling pangs of the light side, and he's like, "Grandfather, tell me how not to feel good anymore. I want to be so fucking evil that you can't redeem me. How do I do it?" And then Darth Vader's ghost says, "I don't fucking know. Don't ask me. I'm dead." So Kylo Ren has to make things up. This guy sits in his room with his posters on the wall, listening to Papa Roach and Linkin Park, listening to Bleed It Out because he is so edgy.
Yeah.
"No one understands me. My dad's a jerk."
The way you're describing it is like he sounds awful.
I don't know. But I like him as the bad guy.
Yeah.
Because you want to see him fail. You do not want to see this guy get his way.
I don't think that's necessarily the case.
Well, he's a good bad guy. That's a good bad guy. You do not want to see the bad guy triumph. Like the Joker, you don't want to see the Joker cut people's faces off, because, no, that's bad.
Another way to say that would be, you want to see the good win in the end?
Yeah.
Even within himself?
Well, yeah, you want to see...
Because it's basically a reverse of Luke. Luke tried to avoid the dark side. Kylo Ren has tried to avoid the light side.
Yeah, so he's parallel, it rhymes.
He
rhymes.
He's talking about, like you were saying, he's talking to his Darth Vader's head, and he's like, show me again, show me the power of the dark side, or I feel it again.
The light side is calling.
Basically talking about how he's feeling the light side, trying to stop him from being an asshole, and he really wants to be an asshole.
Yeah. He's so edgy. So,
like, I didn't know what to think whenever he took off his mask. Because you're so used to Star Wars, he's an intimidating guy, or he's scarred and awful. This is just some guy.
Yeah, he's not scarred. He wants to be like Darth Vader, so he wears a mask. He has no reason to wear the mask otherwise. He looks like every other guy. In fact, he looks a little bit like Snape from the Harry Potter series.
Yeah, a lot of people have been saying that.
Severus Snape.
Like, if they wanted to do a prequel to Harry Potter like that...
Yeah, this guy would be a really good casting choice. But as for his character, he almost looks like Anakin.
Yeah.
And he plays a good parallel to Anakin.
I thought that, like... I guess it would be months ago, not years... Like, maybe 1 year ago, an image of him came out in... It's either Entertainment Weekly or Empire Magazine, showing him without his mask leading two snowtroopers. And it's like, that looks like angry Anakin.
And it turns out it is angry Anakin.
Yeah.
Just his grandson.
Yeah.
And it was perfect. I felt that he was the perfect bad guy for this movie. Because he threw temper tantrums. Mm-hmm. In the originals... Darth Vader would throw a temper tantrum, but it would to kill one of his generals.
At most, he would force choke a guy.
Yeah, he would force choke a guy and said, apology accepted. Because he was very in control of his emotions. He was just angry. That was his default. Mm-hmm. He was calm and angry. He hated you. You know he hated you. So... Don't voice your opinion around him, or he will strangle you to death. You're promoted, General. Oh, God, no! So, in this, he's not calm. He's angry. He's emotional. He's everything that Anakin Skywalker was at the end of Return of the Jedi.
Revenge of the Sith?
Yeah, Revenge of the Sith, sorry. Revenge of the Sith. Yeah. So this plays a good parallel to that prequel. And I really like that. It was really solid performance, too. I love to hate this guy.
Like, I was watching it again, and I was like, his voice does not fit a villain either.
No.
But I keep having to remind myself, that's exactly the point.
That's why he's wearing the voice-changing... helmet.
He isn't exactly a villain. He's just trying really hard to be an absolute cunt.
Yeah. So, he's trying to interrogate Rey. And he's using the Force on her, trying to get this information out of her. And when she starts resisting and fighting back, she finds that she can use the Force to manipulate his mind. And she's actually really, really good at it.
Mm-hmm.
Because... you know, instead of him reading her emotions, she's like, and you're trying to be Darth Vader.
Don't say that. I'm my own man, damn it.
Part of that scene reveals that she had some connection to the island that Luke is at.
Yeah.
I see the ocean, and I can see the island. And he's like, I can take anything I want, meaning he can take whatever memories she might have.
Yeah. So he's looking, she has he's memories
for,
of that.
He's looking for the map in her mind, since he doesn't have the droid.
But when he fails and he finds that she's force sensitive, we actually see Supreme Emperor Snoke.
Supreme Leader
Snoke. And instead of being a 50-foot tall alien monster on a chair, it's a hologram, so he's probably 3 foot tall.
Maybe.
Or he's
I've heard that he's
Or he's a Gungan.
I've heard he's 7 feet.
Meh. He's probably gonna be 4 feet tall. Or a Gungan. If he's 7 feet tall, that's Gungan height.
Yeah.
So if that just turns out to be a fake hologram thing, I just made this face because I like to.
Oh god, I hope so.
I hope so too.
That CGI is or that the CGI doesn't bother me, it's the character design that bothers me.
Yeah, he just has a messed up, weird face.
He's like...
People have said, oh, it's Boba Fett because... No, that's fucking stupid.
I don't know if I've heard that one. That's kind of silly.
Everyone's silly.
But, He's like... The concept art that I've seen, which I need to show you at some point, he looks much creepier. Like, he looks basically like he does in the movie, but there's something creepier about him. He looks weaker. In a sense,
he's definitely not what I was hoping for a Supreme Emperor, but he works. He looks old and weird and creepy.
I hope he like, even in the original movies before special editions, the Emperor looked different.
Yeah,
movie to movie.
I call that the Weird Eyes Emperor.
Yeah, so maybe they'll do something like that and they'll fix him.
Just imagine, that's like Jar Jar wearing an emperor mask, and those eyes are actually his Gungan eyes.
What was I going to say?
I don't know. But, we get to see Kylo Ren explain that I couldn't get the information out of Rey because she's force sensitive, so I can train her to be a Sith Lord like me. Kyle, you're a fucking moron, but bring her to me. Yeah. And Kyle goes back, and he sees that Rey has escaped because she used the Force on the stormtrooper in the room. She was like, come here, undo my cuffs. He's like, I'll tighten those fucking cuffs. How dare you talk to me like that, bitch? And she's like, undo the cuffs.
Remove these restraints and leave the room with... And leave the door open or something like that.
And then he's like, okay, I'll do it.
And as he's leaving, she says, and you'll drop your weapon, and I'll drop my weapon. And he drops it.
I like to think that he wasn't even under mind control right then. He was just like, I'm fired anyway. Fuck it. He knew it was going on, so he didn't even try to resist it. He just walked the fuck away.
Supposedly, that is the newest James Bond in that stormtrooper outfit.
That would be hilarious. Just imagine the newest James Bond going into the mess hall, taking off his helmet, sitting in front of it, and being like, this is what my life has come to.
Way back when, during the media blitz, Simon Pegg was talking about The Force Awakens and how Daniel Craig, the new James Bond, plays a stormtrooper in the movie, and that's the stormtrooper he plays.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So, Rey is exhibiting Force powers, and people have a lot of problem with this, but I don't, because it moves the plot along.
Because
if she didn't, they would be walking and talking in circles or something, so fuck it.
Yeah.
It gets the plot moving.
It's like, Luke didn't have that much training either. I mean, he kind of did, but not really.
He trained for a few weeks in Yoda's whatever.
And Obi-Wan gave him that little ball thing, and he was like, here.
Your target practice.
With your mind.
And that but was, I can't that, see. And that That's pretty, the fucking point, Luke.
That was pretty much it, and then Obi-Wan died.
You'll eat thunder and shit lightning. Okay. Then, oh wait, Poe lives. We find out that Poe lives. We don't find out really how he got back to the Resistance, but he got back to the Resistance. Anyway,
I loved Poe and Finn's relationship. It was romantic.
Yeah. Most believable romance in the movie.
Yeah.
I didn't feel the romance between Finn and Poe. Not Finn and Rey.
I don't think they're going to do anything with Finn and Rey. I think it's just going to be
a plutonic relationship.
Finn wants to like Rey that way, but Rey doesn't like him that way.
Yeah. It seems like that. And then she's going to become a Jedi and be like...
Finn and Poe, however, we'll see.
Yeah, though. It'll be Brobeck Mountain. They'll be stuck on a planet together.
Yeah.
And then they'll form a bond.
It's a beautiful romance.
It is.
Where were
beautiful
we?
Beautiful story.
We started talking about gay couples.
Started on the speculation again. Poe lived. Finn, Han, Leia, and all those people said they were going to make a plan to destroy this Death Star thing. And, they do. Poe and Han and Chewie go to the planet and they're going to blow the fucker up.
Did you say Poe, Han, and Chewie?
Yeah, Han, Chewie, and Finn. Finn. Sorry. I get my names messed up because they're more sounds and less names. So they go to the planet, they're going to blow it up. They find Rey. She's like, I know how to use the Force now. How? I don't fucking know. Why are you questioning me, Finn? Then she beats the fuck out of him again. Anyway, so they're about to escape, and then they see the X-Wings fighting over the Death Planet, and they're like dying. So Han Solo's like, we've got a bag full of explosives. We're going to set them along these pylons and blow them fuck up. You in, Chewie? Chewie's like, whatever. So they place these thermal detonator grenade things, and they're going to blow the fuck out of the Death Planet core thing.
Yeah.
And then Kylo Ren shows up. He sensed his father, Han Solo. Dun dun dun. And they stand over a large walkway platform thing.
Empire.
Yeah. If you are in a Star Wars movie, do not stand on a walkway. These mean certain death. So Han Solo approaches Kylo Ren and says, Ben! Ben, your mother wants you to come home and have supper with her. She's lonely in the home.
That was my favorite part.
You never call.
It was my favorite part, hearing the reveal of his name.
Yeah.
It's like, I thought they did the revelation of Han Solo being his father.
Yeah, kind of early, kind of premature.
Not that it was early, it's just that it's like they kept trying to reiterate it to make sure that nobody's dumb enough to forget.
Misinterpret.
It's like, the worst moment was Supreme Leader Snoke saying,
Your father, Han Solo.
Han Solo, and it zooms in on his face like, I get it. You just had to say your father. I get it. Another thing like that happens too, it doesn't have to do with Han Solo being his father, it's General Hux is talking to Snoke and he's like, we are going to take out the government, and then it does a close-up profile of General Hux and he says, the Republic. I was like, I'm pretty sure Snoke knows the government. It's like, it was a lot, like, he's treating Snoke as the audience. Are you getting this? Did you not read the opening crawl? I'm like, come on, we get it.
Yeah.
Those little things, those bother me the most. Anyway.
Yeah, those were a little forced. But
yeah.
Han Solo and Kyle, Ben...
Ben Solo.
Ben Solo are standing on the walkway and they're like, you know, Dad, come here. I feel the tug of the light pulling me.
I'm being torn apart.
Being torn apart.
I know what I have to do, but I don't know if I have the strength to do it.
You're tearing me apart, Han Solo!
Yeah.
He says that and holds his lightsaber out.
As
Han Solo's like, what the fuck am I supposed to do with this? So he touches it.
Mm-hmm.
And we see the lightsaber is not pointed toward Han Solo.
It's pointed to the side.
Yeah. But apparently, you know, they were kind of fondling it or something, and it gets turned and pointed toward Han Solo.
Like, he turns it at the last second. Like, you can see them fighting over it, kind of, like...
Kind of. It's not really a fight, just kind of a... But we get a really good descriptive scene.
Mm-hmm.
They're both standing on the walkway, a door is open, shining in the light, and earlier they say, as long as we have light, there is hope.
Yeah. Poe says that.
Yeah. And we see the light slowly fade away
from Ben's face, Kylo's face.
Kylo Ben's face.
Mm-hmm.
And he succumbs to the dark side and turns on his lightsaber and impales Han Solo.
Yeah.
Killing him. He is dead. So unless he's a Time Lord or some sort of immortal alien who will come back like Gandalf the White.
Mm-hmm.
I am Han Solo the White. Come to turn the tide. Yeah, that's not going to happen. Han Solo's fucking dead, people. You hear that? You hear the character that you love? Han Solo's dead.
As he should be, I think.
Yeah.
I'm surprised there wasn't more backlash, but whenever I first heard that, because I knew about that too, way back.
I didn't, but I kind of figured that since you said someone's going to die and like it's going to be Han Solo.
Did I ever say that?
Yeah, you did.
I don't remember saying that.
You said someone's going to die, and I'm like, it's either going to be Chewie or Han, and I think Chewie is more marketable.
I might have said that Han Solo was probably going to die before I knew. Anyway, what was I saying? I'm surprised there wasn't more backlash to Han Solo being killed in this movie.
Well, Harrison Ford wanted it to end, so I'm just agreeing to it. Whatever.
He was kind of useless in Return of the Jedi. They gave him something to do, and then they killed him in this, so...
Yeah.
He never has to be useless ever again.
Unless they find him in a block of carbonite again, he's good.
Yeah.
They killed him off. Good. He got a ceremonious end. Didn't get a funeral, which is a shame. There's a funeral in almost every movie.
There might be one next movie.
Okay. Good for him.
That's what I'm assuming will happen.
So, Chewie has the best outrage moment where he's like, I wish that he had torn off a stormtrooper's arm. I wish he had like run up to a stormtrooper and just and threw him over the side.
This is what we were talking about earlier. This movie gives Chewie the most character out of any of the movies because of that scene alone, basically.
Yeah, you know, he roars and shoots stormtroopers in the face and then blows up the, you know,
shoots Kylo Ren in the abdomen with his thing,
bow launcher thing, and you know he does damage. He blows it up, and I kind of thought that he died like in a suicidal rage.
Yeah, whatever.
Blowing himself up.
Like that's kind of a near suicidal act. Like,
yeah,
my friend just died. Fuck this. I'm taking you
my
out.
My boyfriend
going
just
with you.
Died.
Yeah. Fuck you.
So, Rey and Finn run out of the exploding death tube.
Kylo Ren chases after him, and he leaves his
mask. He doesn't chase. He teleports.
Well, he starts running after him, but he somehow gets ahead of him.
The thing is, he's limping.
Yeah.
He cannot run because he's got a wound in his gut.
Yeah.
But he teleports in front of them.
Yeah.
That must be a Sith power.
That's the only thing I can think of where it's a bad editor or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's a small thing. I can forgive it. Or it's not really a small thing. It's kind of weird, but whatever.
It's kind of one of those slap in the face moments. That's one of the problems I have with the movie.
Yeah.
But to get the plot done, all right, whatever. We get this.
Anyway, the reason I brought it up is he left his helmet, so he might have a new thing in the next movie, or no helmet at all.
Yeah, he might not have no helmet, or he might have a entire shelf full of them.
Maybe.
Maybe this one won't have little indents over the little mouth plate.
Yeah.
Where the leather is pressed. So, Kylo Ren confronts Rey and Finn. Rey gets thrown like a bag of potatoes, and Finn has only his lightsaber, or Anakin's lightsaber, to defend himself with.
Mm-hmm.
And Finn tries to put up a fight, but he gets wrecked.
Yeah.
And then Kyle, like, extends his hand, and he's trying to get the lightsaber out of the lightly packed snow, because as we all know, lightly packed snow is a lightsaber, a Force user's ultimate weakness.
Yeah.
A few inches away, lightly packed snow will grab onto it and hold it tight. No, you aren't getting this lightsaber. But, Kyle's trying to pull it out, and it turns out Rey's pulling with her Force power, so she gets the lightsaber. And she kind of holds it a little goofy. It's like she can't really find the right grip for it.
She's never held a lightsaber before, so...
You don't know. She might have used lightsabers.
Well,
she may have a collection at home.
well, some people think her staff is a lightsaber.
Yeah, so. I kind of hope it is. I hope it has like little.
We'll talk about the staff during speculation. Speaking of, we're an hour and 22 minutes.
Yeah, but. This is going to be amazing. Rey wrecks Kyle, which Kyle is already wounded, so that makes a little bit of sense why her, a fresh Force user and lightsaber user, is able to beat a Dark Lord.
This is the thing. People are complaining about Rey and Finn holding any kind of power over Kylo. One, he just killed his father, and he's emotionally wrecked over that.
Yeah.
Because we established that his character is being pulled by the light side as well as the dark side.
Mm-hmm.
He got a bowcaster bolt into the gut.
Yeah.
So, those two things alone pretty much weaken him. And he kicks Finn's ass, and it takes two people to take him down, even with all that.
Yeah.
So, overall,
I would say
it seems pretty appropriate.
Her odds are pretty good.
Yeah.
But she's starting to get wrecked, pushed over the edge, and Kyle's like, I can teach you the ways of the Force. And she's like, oh yeah, the Force.
Yeah.
Durr! So then she starts kicking his ass, poking him with the lightsaber, and I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah,
she has a very different combat style.
She is very untrained, and she's used to the staff, so she just jabs people with it all the time.
Yeah, so she's poking him in the shoulders, and he's like, oh, what the fuck?
She has a very similar fighting style to Palpatine with his lightsaber. He did the same thing.
You know, she doesn't cut off his leg, but she clips his leg and cuts off a little bit of his cape, and she pokes him in the shoulders, and she cuts his face, so now he has a reason to wear the mask. So when he goes back to the Star Destroyer and gets all healed up, he's going to be like, oh, cool, I have a scar. This is awesome. We can fix that up for you, sir. No, I'm going to keep it. Oh, this is awesome. I mean, this is horrible. I'm going to wear a mask now. Can I have the breathing thing? Your breathing's just fine, sir. I'm going to do the breathing thing. Now I'm just like him. So, he has a reason to wear a mask now because his face is all fucked up. And he got wrecked, but he was not killed because there was a giant gap in the ground.
A chasm coincidentally separated them.
Yeah.
More coincidence.
So Chewie flies the Millennium Falcon, saves Finn and Rey, and they leave the exploding Death Hoth as it blows up.
Oh, and Hux is screaming at Snoke saying, they're destroying the planet, we're gonna die. And he's like, bring Kylo back to me, we shall complete his training.
Yeah. Which, I forgot to mention, Phasma, she's on the planet this.
See, that's how much impact she has, we completely forgot.
Han and Finn are trying to lower the shield so the X-Wings can blow up the planet, and they find her, kidnap her.
I do love that they had Chewie tackle her because she's so big.
Well, he's a Yeti. He's going to tackle the fuck out of her.
You're the biggest. You take her out.
What do you mean you don't want to? Your sugar's low. Well, here's a mint. Okay, here's a moon pie. Don't let your diabetes get in the way again. Because he's old. Get it? Get it! Anyway, we get to have Han say, where can we put her? Is there a garbage chute? Is there a trash compactor? And then she's gone.
Yeah.
We don't get to see her ever again. Presumably, she's in a trash compactor that is not working at the best of times, and she's blown up.
Mm-hmm.
Or she crawled out, got into a TIE fighter, and left, and she's back with the First Order. It doesn't fucking matter because she left no impression.
I was thinking she could come back where the trash compactor, since like the widest thing of the suits or their helmets, because they're like, they got the wide jowls, have her mask like crush her face a bit, so she gets it removed and she's scarred, and she would come back in just the scuffed up suit, and she would have a scarred face. That'd be pretty badass to have captains.
It's like the trash compactor is the only thing that survived from a planet floating through space. It lands on a planet. She comes out. Ah, after 10,000 years, I'm free. Time to conquer Earth.
I think it'd be pretty cool to have a captain of the stormtroopers with a fucked up face.
Yeah.
And it'd be a woman. That'd be pretty cool. Anyway.
Yeah. Anyway, speculations. The Death Hoth blows up. Everyone's congratulating. Leia sees Rey, who she's never seen before. Wink, wink, hint, hint, nudge, nudge. And yeah. They hug, and they're like, oh, Han's dead.
That's another problem I had.
Yeah.
She should have hugged Chewie.
Yeah, Chewie's
He just lost his best friend, and fucking... She completely ignores him.
Yeah, Chewie and Han have been together for like 40 years. They're basically married. So... Chewie's like...
He's basically a brother-in-law.
Yeah. He's family. And now Han's gone, and Chewie's like, I don't have nothing to do. I guess I got the shitty Millennium Falcon.
The most we get besides his freak out is him, that shot of him, just he has his hand on his face. He just looks kind of sad.
Yeah.
He should have got another hug. I know she hugged him whenever he saw first her again, came up. But
yeah.
You can give him two hugs. Fuck it.
Yeah. I mean, it's Chewy. It's like a walking couch. It's a big old puppy. And then Rey gets the coordinates because guess who wakes up?
Oh,
R2-D2.
That's another dumb thing.
Yeah, out of nowhere, R2-D2 has been sleeping for 30 years.
He's been asleep and sad for the past 20 or so years.
Yeah, so he finally wakes up as soon as Han dies. He's like, blah, 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 blah. What do you mean you found the map? Like, if they had said, oh, R2-D2 is running the... diagnostic on this map trying to decipher it. Okay, mm-hmm. He's running in low power mode trying to use his computer to decipher this map. Gotcha. No, yeah. He's just sad. Then he wakes up and he's like, oh, I'm happy now. Beep, 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 pew. So, he wakes up and, they fill in the map because they couldn't have deciphered this little chunk of the map without the big map. Whatever. Rey finds the map. Finn is, like, in a hospital bed being worked on because he's still fucked up. Rey's like, I'll be back for you, my friend. Friend zone.
Yeah.
So she takes R2-D2 and Chewie and the Millennium Falcon, and she heads out to this distant, faraway system to find Luke. Mm-hmm. They park about 40 miles away from Luke, so Rey has to climb.
Yeah.
Why, they couldn't have just floated over and said... Oh, hey, Luke, you still there? Here's a lightsaber. And they hold on that shot for like 5 minutes so that they can do a helicopter shot around them.
They really didn't need that helicopter shot.
No, but we get to see Luke Skywalker looking a whole lot like Ben Kenobi.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that. But Luke said nothing. Yeah. He turns around and he's like,
I know that saber.
No, he doesn't even say that. He doesn't have any look of familiarity. He's just like, I'm staring. So yeah, good movie. I liked it. There were some problems, but I think that
Death Star, R2-D2, Phasma.
And C-3PO's red arm. Which served no purpose other than to have people say, what the fuck?
That's another thing. It's another instance of people being, the character being... too obvious, so that way the audience gets it. He's like, might not have recognized me with my red arm. It's like, they were basically saying, hey, you see this? This is different from what I used to look like, audience, just in case you don't know. I'm like, we got it. If they don't know, screw it. They can watch the older movies. They can figure it out.
Yeah. I mean, I heard that there was a comic book that came out to explain that, but it's going to be a really short fucking comic when like C-3PO's walking through a hall and he like bumps it against the wall and it like gets caught and he's like, oh dear, I cannot move my arm anymore. He goes to a replacement thing and it's like, do you have a spare arm that I can use while you fix this one?
Yeah, here.
Mm-hmm. That's a short goddamn comic and they, really fucking pointless.
They bring up he says it and they show him with the red arm, and then at the end, as they're waving bye to the Millennium Falcon going to Luke, he has his golden arm back.
Yeah, no explanation. Just, oh, he's got his gold arm again. Bye. The fuck? Are you not going to keep the red arm? Is this not going to be a plot?
It would be much cooler to not mention it and just have him have it.
Yeah.
Just like in Empire, he just had the silver leg. Nobody
in all
it.
Of them, he had the silver leg.
Did he?
Yeah.
I don't remember.
It's kind of weird. But yeah, in Empire and Return of the Jedi, he had a silver leg and no one mentions it. In fact, no one noticed it until like 30 years later and they're like, hey, he's got a silver leg. What? No fucking way.
Cool. Awesome, guys.
There's no reason to bring it up.
Literally. No reason. But what the fuck ever.
Yeah.
I like the movie. It's really, really standing up for me. Not as good as the first or even the second Star Wars, in my opinion, but yeah. Like, it stands up against them, with them. I would watch this one along with the original prequels.
Which is more than I was expecting. Mm-hmm. I was thinking it would be in between better than prequels, but not as good as the originals. It's better
almost
than
like Pirates of the Caribbean. Like, it's not bad, but it's not something I would watch over and over again.
Yeah. It's like right there behind Empire, or behind A New Hope, depending on what. Because those two are kind of interchangeable for me.
Would you say this new movie is better than Fifth Element?
I don't know.
It's like apples to pineapples there. It's like, no, these aren't the same thing.
No, I'd probably like Fifth Element more.
Yeah, me too.
But as much as I like Star Wars, it's definitely up there with A New Hope and Empire. Or, like I said, like just behind Empire and ahead of Jedi.
Yeah. The special effects were really good. I was impressed by those. The characters were really good. Mm-hmm. Kyle worked for me. Phasma could go just float through space for all I care. She's dead. General Hux, while not impressive, is not a sour note like I thought he was going to be.
He's like... How would you say it? He's like Kylo's unappreciated younger brother to your father, Snoke.
Yeah, he almost comes off as the little brother. It's like, see? He's not so cool. I, on the other hand, I can do this. Kyle didn't even get the plans from the droid. He could have.
Yeah.
Shut up!
But at the same time, he's kind of more mature than Kylo, so he could be an older brother also. There's some kind of sibling rivalry going on there.
And I do appreciate that.
Yeah.
Phenomenally. I would stack this up against the prequels. So what would you say? Final score, worth it or not worth it?
Worth it.
Worth it.
Even the two horrible experiences.
Yeah. Go to a theater with really comfortable seats. That seems to be the defining factor.
And good image, good screen, good audio. Yeah.
If you've got a crummy theater in town, don't go to it. Go to the next two towns over and get a really good theater
experience.
But
what does that say about a movie if the seating can make it boring like that?
Yeah, you're right, because we saw Krampus in almost the exact same seats. And, of course, it was just us three.
Yeah.
And we watched it, and we enjoyed it. But we were the only three there.
Like, even whenever I saw it, like, not opening day, but the day after opening day. And there was, like, one other party of people, and there was just two other people in there.
Yeah, I'd seen it before, and... Yeah, me and my brother. And it was crowded. But not very crowded. Not like Star Wars crowded.
Yeah.
For the next movie, I'm going to suggest that nobody lead into the hype.
Yeah.
I want everyone to just chill the fuck out.
Yeah.
Quit overanalyzing it. Leave the outrageous speculation to the pros. You just sit down and just wait for the movie. Buy the toys and... play with your fucking lightsabers.
Oh no, you bought Phasma.
You know, we saw the toys, but...
Oh, that's another thing. So many of those toys had less screen time than the original, like, background character toys did. Like, I don't think Sarko Plank ever showed up.
Who is Sarko Plank?
He's the in that one extended universe or expanded universe novel that fought Luke, fought Luke Skywalker, he's supposedly on Jakku and he has like an insect helmet face. Helmet. You've seen it, right?
I guess. If I have, I have not paid attention.
Constable Zuvio, he was going to be on Jakku. He didn't show up. And those are two of the cooler characters that I wanted to see, and they weren't there. L.O. Asti, he was in the movie. Thank God for that. He was the, fish pilot guy.
Yeah.
Not a Mon Calamari, but he's like a catfish man.
Yeah.
Vober Dand was in there. He was the bearded guy talking to Leia. I think it was mainly Constable Zuvio and Sarko Plank not being used, which is unfortunate.
We didn't see any in-service AT-ATs.
No, we didn't.
We should have seen some in-service AT-ATs.
You see them in the background during the speech, but that's it.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. That's cool.
That's kind of disappointing. Oh, that one character, the first character you ever seen from The Force Awakens, what's it called? He's that turtle looking guy who's like had pets on his back or whatever.
Yeah.
Or animals. Anyway, he only showed up for like a split second.
One scene. He grunted.
At least he was there.
Yeah.
My favorite puppet didn't get a toy, and it was the robot Jawa.
Yeah, what the heck was that? It's like a cyborg Jawa.
The scavengers are cleaning their findings, and
that one's like bossing them around.
Rey is daydreaming, and this robot Jawa screams at her. He's like, "Get back to work!" I love that thing.
Yeah,
and all of the the microphone mouth thing that reports them to the First Order, along with that woman.
Yeah, now that was a cool robot. I like that. Made out of clearly obvious scraps found around the studio. Just kind of...
Like, there's a robot like that in Empire, too.
Yeah.
Or at least one that has a...
Speaker for
microphone.
Mouth,
yeah. Mouth.
Kind of like that.
I like the mosquito alien puppets in the bar.
I like the puppets on Jakku, like when that one guy's trying to steal BB-8, and that one guy's on that big robot cow.
Oh, yeah.
He's got a net on BB-8.
Tweedo or Tito or whatever his name is.
Yeah.
And there's that one scavenger, he's like this giant guy, and he's carrying a giant thing.
Big bag of stuff, and he's got robot arms.
Yeah.
Maybe his species is like a slug species with legs, and he has to have robot arms.
Oh. Lots of neat things. But a lot of the neat things that we saw ended up getting cut out, unfortunately.
Yeah, which I believe there's going to be a special edition, just a few months after they release it on DVD and Blu-ray.
J.J. Abrams said something about not editing it any further. So
no director's cut?
Yeah, probably not.
Oh, well.
But there will be deleted scenes, so...
Okay, well, we'll get that much.
But, should we speculate about... we're an hour and 41 minutes.
Yeah, we'll speculate on the next movie. Darth Jar Jar confirmed. Luke's daughter confirmed.
No. I refuse.
Well, you can refuse all day. It's still going to happen.
I think Kylo, through the Force, will find out that Poe shot Finn's friend and will try to use that against them. Just tear them apart somehow.
Bring him back into the First Order. We've got candy!
Yeah.
That, like my new master.
That'll probably be brought up.
Yeah, Ray fucked up my face. And my lungs. And my lungs. I have to have a breathing respirator. It's like you forget to breathe through your respirator sometimes.
I wonder if part of Kylo will be thankful to Ray for fucking his face up. Supposedly, Maz is a little bit older than Yoda in some... way? I don't know.
Probably.
But
They probably bumped elbows a couple of times. It's a small universe, after all.
I'm thinking Ghost Anakin might show up in the next movie.
Yeah, Hayden Christensen's going to show up as a Force ghost, and he's going to be like...
But can they get him to act this time?
He's going to... No, they don't need him to act. They need him to look all brooding. They need to put eyeliner under his eyes and...
Kyle, do as I say and destroy the Jedi.
And that's going to be the Darth ghost that, like, Kyle kind of hints at seeing.
Show me what to do. Show me again.
They could hint at it being a delusion.
Yeah.
Than an actual...
Like, what's his name? Snoke putting visions in his head or something?
Yeah.
And it's going to be young Hayden Christensen Skywalker. He's going to be like,
I tried to destroy the Jedi, and Luke cut me down before I could.
Well, supposedly Kylo already knows about Darth Vader
turning at the
last moment, saying that it was a momentary lapse of reason. There was back when the Knights of Ren was announced, it had something to Ren somehow being connected to the word Padme, which is like a Sanskrit word for lotus, I think. Like lotus flower. So Knights of Ren could be Knights of Padme. So could be a tribute to his mother, as Anakin was obsessed with bringing Padme back to life. And maybe that's part of Kylo's mission as well.
Kylo's grandma. It's like...
I don't know.
Maybe. We'll just have to see when the new movie comes out.
That's in 500-something days. Almost 2 years.
About 2 years, we're going to see the next movie, and it's going to disappoint everyone, and everyone's going to give up. And then the third movie won't get made because it'll have such poor returns.
They made a lot of... Oh, they made $1 billion in, like, 12 days.
They could start up their own micronation with all the money that they've procured.
Maybe.
From this film.
It's... I can't... Which made more money, Titanic or Avatar?
Avatar.
Did it? In 12 days, it's already gotten to $1 billion in sales.
Buy Star Wars merchandise, and Marvel merchandise, and old cartoon merchandise.
Yeah.
Because who doesn't love Mickey Mouse? It's going to be awesome, guys.
I'm still scared about a movie a year forever.
It's going to be awesome. We're never going to get tired of it. It's never going to end.
I'm already tired of it.
Enjoy the hype train. Because we're riding it all the way to the apocalypse. Choo-choo! What's the next one? Rogue Squadron? Rebel Assault?
Rogue One.
Rogue One and the...
Han Solo movie.
Oh, there's a Han Solo movie. I know there was supposed to be a Boba Fett movie.
That one might still be in works, but Han Solo is after Rogue One.
Oh, God.
I don't think they've cast Han Solo yet. I wonder who they'll get. Rian Johnson is writing Star Wars 8 and 9. Rian Johnson is directing 8. Colin Trevorrow is directing 9.
I'm looking forward to them, but I'm definitely not getting in the hype. I'm definitely not going to look up pre-scripts and post-scripts.
I am.
Yeah,
I say that I'm not going to, but
you're going
I'm probably
to ruin
going
it
to.
For yourself.
Don't, again.
Don't ruin it for yourself.
Although, a lot of the spoilers were right, but... they didn't ruin it, I don't think.
Well, I think that's a wrap. I think we've talked about just about everything we can talk about.
Do you think you'll be seeing it again anytime soon?
Not until it comes out on DVD.
Yeah, it's supposed to come out April 5th, I think, is their projected release date.
That's relatively soon, just... 4-ish months away.
Yeah. 3. So, no.
4 months.
Yeah, 4 months.
Because this is December, January, February, March, April. So, 4-point-whatever months. And, yeah, we'll be able to obsess about a new trilogy.
Oh, man. that movie will be really easy to fan edit, just to fix the little things. There's so few things wrong with it that you can fix.
Yeah.
Any idiot with editing software could fix that movie.
That's what makes it perfect. Hopefully George Lucas won't buy back the rights and edit out these new movies so that they're terrible.
I don't know. I don't think
they would. It's like if George Lucas comes back for the second movie.
I don't know.
He brings back Jar Jar.
I don't know if they would sell back to him. Probably not.
Be awesome. It'd be terrible, but it'd be awesome. It's like, yeah, I don't like anything that the new stuff did, so yeah, I'm going to remove this from the Chamber of Commerce, or the National Library, whatever you call it, and yeah, I'm going to re-release the prequels with new HD graphics and new CGI. I'm going to put Jar Jar in every scene. You guys hated Jar Jar? I don't care. We're going to have more of him. You see this? Jar Jar. He's in the Senate. He's making decisions. He's making all the wrong decisions. You know why? Because he's the Sith. Darth Jar Jar. So we've talked for about an hour and 54 minutes, so I think that's it.
Around 2 hours.
See you guys later.
You're going to want to hit...
Don't forget to like, favorite, subscribe, comment for more.
Yeah. You don't want to see this. It's trash.
Yeah, and get our pointless opinions.